bless you. We thank God for you for joining back with us again. Had a little problem to take care of, but we thank God for bringing us back on the air one more time. I am your pastor, Pastor Charles Williams, Life in the Word Christian Center in Pontiac, Michigan. We just want to go into a brief word of prayer as we go before the Lord in our studies on tonight. Father, we thank you for your kindness, your mercy, and your grace. Thank you for blessing us. We ask that you speak to our hearts. We ask that you bind the devil in every hand, give strength and deliverance to those that's in need, and help of you in the name of Jesus. Father, speak to us. Speak to our hearts and our minds. Let us receive your word with joy and gladness by faith in Jesus' name. Amen. As I was saying before, on this December the 1st, 2021, we want to just be thankful for what God has done. And remember, I preached a few messages ago or Sunday that we're not thanking God for at this time of the season, this time of the year. We thank God every day, starting in January all the way through. And we want to make sure that we are gearing ourselves up for victory. There's so much going on. We are in the time where people commit suicide. They get depressed, get despondent, stressed out, confused, because the loved ones they once had are not here. We're praying for those in Oxford, Michigan, that has lost loved ones in the school shooting. We're praying for those because, once again, everybody don't know how to handle tragedy and death, whether it's family or friends or even just knowing somebody down in your neighborhood. And we're praying that God will intervene and touch their minds and their hearts and comfort them. That if they have not given their life to the Lord, that this incident or incidents that has happened, even the one in, I don't know the city, but where the man drove his vehicle through the Christmas parade, that people will give their life over to the Lord. We're praying. Saints, we got to pray. Let me just take some time out. We got to pray. We got to pray for our churches. We got to pray for our leaders in the body of Christ. I'm not talking about denomination. I'm talking about the leaders in the body of Christ. We have to pray for them. That as y'all pray for us, that we will stand strong on the tower, the watchman. That we will be sincere. I'm talking about really being sincere and watching out for your souls. Those that are members of our churches, those that are not members of our churches, those that are in our neighborhoods that don't even belong to any churches. That we will proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ. I made a comment on Sunday, and I think before, I said there are certain times, you know, the devil is trying to kill, steal, kill, and destroy all the time. That's what's in him, his nature. And so there are times where he tries to ramp up stuff to get more souls into hell. And that's when the saints, we should ramp up more to get more souls into heaven. That's why now people are having national and local prayer conferences and lines over the phone. 6 in the morning, 7 in the morning, 7 at night, 9 and 12. God is touching the saints' hearts that we will even do more. I don't care if you're 80 years old. There's something for you to do in the kingdom. I don't care if you 5 years old. There is something for you to do in the kingdom. I don't care the disability that you have. There is something for you to do in the kingdom as you are a kingdom citizen, a child of God. We got to pray for our churches to stand up for righteousness. Pray for our churches that they will project the kingdom of God. Pray for our leaders that we won't just be slew-footed no more, lazy, unconcerned, pigeon-toed, not needed, box ankle. That we will look and see and teach and preach right. Instead of being cross-sided and looking and talking and acting crazy. Because if the leaders do it, the church is going to do it. That means the world is going to follow it. And then now we're following the world. But God gives the church a chance to get back on track. Bible said, I believe that's 2 Chronicles 7:14. If my people, which are called by my name, will humble themselves and pray, seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then when I hear from heaven, I will forgive their sin and I will heal their land. God is a merciful God. I'm telling you from experience, God is a merciful God. So saints, it's time for us to get up, brush ourselves off. Lord, I'm sorry for not doing what I supposed to have done, and go for it. Do you not know God loves you so much that he cares for you, that he don't just allow the devil to take you out? He cares for you. Jesus is interceding, praying for us. He's our high priest. He's praying for us in heaven. He is the good shepherd. And we can do better. We can. Tell yourself, I can do better. We can do better. The body of Christ can do better. Why? Because God is on our side. We have to pray for our governments everywhere. I'm not talking about the United States. United States, Israel, Australia, every government. We got to pray that they will do the will of the Lord. The Bible said, pray for those that's in authority. We have to pray for them. We know everybody ain't going to do right. We know everybody ain't saved up in the government. We know people feel or possessed with the devil. But at the same time, we got to pray for those folks. That God, by his power, would touch their minds, turn around. The Bible said, I believe it's in Proverbs 20th chapter, the 21st or 22nd chapter of Proverbs. The first verse, it said, the king's heart is in the hand of the Lord as the rivers of water. He turneth whithersoever he will. If God can make those heathen kings, Nebuchadnezzar, Cyrus, and Darius, to do what he wants to do, God can touch the people's heart, these presidents and dictators' hearts up today, council members and mayors and governors, it don't matter, teachers, whoever, God can touch their hearts today. We have to pray for our families. We know some of our family members are crazy. They need help spiritually and mentally. So we got to pray for them. We got to ask God, Lord, give me what to say. Show them how to get the right help, to call on the name of Jesus. Because we've gone too far where we're asking other entities and yet we're not consulting God first. And God is not pleased with that, church. I'm talking to the church. I ain't talking to the world. The world's supposed to do what they do, but the church is supposed to call on the name of the Lord, their God. Amen? We got to pray for our schools, these school shootings. We don't want them become where they become just the norm. Let me say that. We want the kids to be able to go to school and learn. Now, at the same time, don't send your kids to school so the teacher can teach them and learn and teach them and discipline them. No, they're supposed to teach them. It is the parents' job to teach and discipline their child at home as well. to reinforce what the parent, what the teacher has said. Today we have gotten to a complacent start. A lot of the parents, where they send the child to school and they want the teacher to do the work for them. It's like the teacher didn't lay down to have those kids. You did. So the parent is the teacher, the nurturer. At home, and when they go to school, they take on what the parent has taught them. As at home, the teacher gives them work and try to put it inside their mind. The child comes back home, and the parent is supposed to help out or enforce what the teacher. So really, they enforce and discipline and character at home, so when they get to school, they know how to conduct themselves. And when the teacher gives them something, give them rules and regulation, it should be lining up with their parents. And if the and if it's not, the child goes back and tell their parents, so the parent and the teacher can be on one accord, not the parent coming up there trying to fight the child. We, the church, have a lot to pray for. A lot. We got a lot, and we can do it. Jesus said, upon this rock I build my church, and what the gates of hell shall not prevail. We got to pray for our neighborhoods. That crime just won't be going roaming around rapid like it has license to do what it wants to do. No, you can make a difference. You can make a difference. Pray and speak up against the insurrection of man. Amen. So we want to just keep watchful and prayerful, steadfast, unmovable, huh? Always abounding in the work of the Lord. 1 Corinthians 15:58. Saints, we have a job to do, and the job has to be done, or God will get somebody else to do the job. So we don't want to neglect our job. We want to be on our job. We want to pray for our churches, the pastors, the leaders in the body of Christ, the schools, the governments, our community. We want to pray that they will have faith and confidence in us to know that if I go to brother so-and-so, sister so-and-so, or if I tell this child, the child will see. I tell people, I teach, that the child at 5 years old can yet witness to their teacher and be an encouragement to their teacher. Why? Because it's the Spirit of God inside that child that would do the work. Amen? So we want to make sure we're staying focused. We're staying focused. We're as I talked about on Sunday, I just want to deal with a little topic that during this time of the season, when November and December come, people are lonely. They get in this lonely, complacent state. I think it's called that melancholic state where you just feel blue, you just don't feel happy. You know, they have lost loved ones. And those that just lost loved ones just yesterday, today, that, you know, we want to help them understand that God sees them and yet He cares for them. And we want to be able to minister salvation and comfort to them. Not saying a lot of lifeless words, but we want to speak life and truth to people that are in need. Listen, people are really in need. Well, first of all, that's the reason why Jesus came. People are really in need of a Savior, which turns around to be also help. And they need a Savior, and His name is Jesus Christ. So, you know, people might think they're alone, but they're really not alone if they give their life to the Lord. Jesus said, "Come unto me, all you that labor and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon thee, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light." The yoke of the Pharisees and Sadducees was heavy to carry. So Jesus said, take my yoke. the yoke of this world, of families and all that. No, take the yoke of the Lord and let him, you know, make things easy for you. Huh? The Bible said, we're going to go into a few scriptures if you got time. Write these scriptures down and you can share them. Share these scriptures with somebody else. Don't just have them for yourself. To share these scriptures with somebody else that is in need. Because people have to realize God is there waiting for them. God is here waiting for us just to call upon him. And he wants us to call upon him. But the devil and his sneaky, low-down, trifling self never wants us to call on the Lord. Because as soon as you call the Lord and you give your life to him, he's going to make everything all right. That does not mean that you'll never, ever go through anything. Jesus went through stuff. Jesus lost his friend Lazarus. Even the Bible says, I believe that's John or Matthew, one of them, 11:35, Jesus wept. That's not a prayer for your food. But the Bible said Jesus wept, even for his friend. So we want to make people understand that God is here to help them. Deuteronomy 31:6 said, be strong and of a good courage. Fear not, nor be afraid of them. For the Lord thy God, he it is that does go with thee. He will not fail thee, nor forsake thee. By trusting in the Lord and obeying him, the saints are victorious in spite of great distress and obstacles. Listen, when we're going through, God understand that a lot of times it's like I said before earlier, some things that happens in people's life affects people, different people differently. It does. I mean, some people, it takes a while to get over stuff. Some people, they can kind of move on. Some people, it will just shake them a little bit, and they can move on. But at the same time, we do, care who you are, we do have to put our trust in the Lord. And ask God, Lord, take me through. Lord, carry me through. Lord, see me out of this. Because the devil would try to come in and get you so distraught, so down and out, that all of a sudden it starts spilling over to other areas in your life, and then it's a word they call it, they say you can end up being toxic, where you contaminate everybody else by what you're going through and holding in. And you're not giving it over to the Lord. You might think you're alone, but you're not alone. God is with you. And he wants to help you. Even if you're unsaved, God wants to help you. But you got to give your life to him. Even with you going through, God is there to help you. The devil wants to kill you. Period. But God wants to give you life, and that more abundantly. Jesus said to his disciples in John, let's turn there, in John 16:33, and we have to realize that no matter what we go through, Jesus is there for us. John 16:33, matter of fact, Jesus says in the 32nd verse, he says, behold, the hour cometh, yea, is now come, that ye shall be scattered, every man to his own, and shall leave me alone, and yet I am not alone. Now, Jesus even saying, yet you shall leave me alone, but yet I am not alone, because the Father is with me. Don't you want the Father to be with you? I'm talking to you that believe that you're alone. you that know that you have not accepted Christ as your Lord and Savior. If you accept Christ as your Lord and Savior, you won't be alone no more. I don't care who forsakes you. David said, well, my mother and my father forsake me, Psalms 27:10, then the Lord would take me up. I don't care who's not around you. I don't care who doesn't want to speak to you. I don't care who's pushing you aside and disregarding you. When you have Christ on the inside, you're not alone no more. The Holy Ghost, when you are baptized and filled with the Holy Ghost will be there for you. Some people say, I just feel all down and out. I just don't seem to be happy, you know. But when the Holy Ghost is inside of you, he will lift you up. He's a father to the fatherless. What's that song? He's my brother. He's my father. He's my sister. You know, sweet Jesus. He's the lily of the valley, the bright and morning star. He's my savior. He's my delight. He's everything to me. I'm talking to you that are alone, to encourage you that if you seek the Lord and give your heart to him, and those of you that have accepted the Lord, if you just lean on him, you won't be alone. Jesus says in that 33rd verse of John, St. John 16, 30, 33, these things have I, when he said, because, he said, yet I am not alone because the Father is with me. These things have I spoken unto you, that in me you might have what? Like peace. In the world you should have what? Tribulation. But be of good cheer, for I have overcome the world. The world, the things that are in the world that the world produces. Death and trauma, tribulation, trials and calamity. He has overcome all sickness and death and pain. He has overcome. He speaks of his crossing over and defeating sin even before the cross. Have you noticed every time Jesus tells the disciples, when they was getting onto the ship, or before they got onto the ship or the boat, he said, let us go over to the other side. He already knew he defeated the winds and the waves and the storms that the disciples were going to face, but he had to let them face it so that they know he is the captain of the sea, the bishop of their souls, their healer and their deliverer and their way maker. You don't have to be alone no more. I'm going to say it again. You don't have to be alone no more. Jesus is waiting on you. Jesus wants to come in and be one with you and you with him and his Father. So when all have forsaken you, nobody is around, yet the Spirit of God is there to give you the joy. Because weeping may endure for a night, Psalms 30:5, but joy cometh in the morning. So what can we do is look unto Jesus for help and comfort, peace, healing in our darkest time. The light of Christ will shine bright on us and in us. Whether your father or mother are deceased or not in your life or have abandoned you, the Lord would take you into his arms if you let him. That's the issue. That's the problem. We have to let him. Too many times we depend on people, and there's nothing wrong with having folks in your life, to talk to and to get words of advice, but first things first. First person needs to be first, and that's Jesus. Lord, I need you. God, I stretch my hands towards thee. No other help I know. All of the grounds are what? Sinking sand. For you are the bridge over water. God, I need your help even now. The Lord will take you into his hands, his arms, if you let him. He is not going to struggle with us or fight us to take us in his hand, but he is there waiting for us, waiting for you. I'm saying this because people are in this time, they really get lonely to a dark mental evil state. And that's the devil. And God don't want you to be like that. He wants you to have the joy of the Lord, for the joy of the Lord is your what? Strength. When people's minds and hearts are distant from us, God is yet there. When people's minds, when people don't even see what we're going through, and their minds they don't understand, yet God is there yet for us. Psalm 62 and 8 says, let's go to the fifth verse. The Bible said, my soul waited thou only upon God. Psalm 62 and 5. For my expectation is from him. He only is my rock and my salvation. He is my defense. I should not be moved. And God is my salvation and my glory. The rock of my strength and my refuge is in God. Trust in him at all times. Whatever you go through, trust in him. The Bible says, trust in the Lord, Proverbs 3 and 5. Trust in the Lord at all times. So trust in the Lord at all times. Ye people, pour out your heart before him. God is a refuge, what? For us, Selah. Trust in him. Trust in God's providence. Trust in God's grace to see you through. We must lay out our grievance, problems before God, and trust in him to help us. Trust again. Trust in God's providence, his protection, his provision. Trust in his grace, his unmerited favor, stuff we don't deserve. Trust in God to help you come through out of your loneliness. Because the devil wants you to be like that so that you will be so contaminated with it that all of a sudden now you become toxic and spread to other people. And that's what the devil wants. He don't want nobody to be happy. He don't want nobody to be joyful. He don't want nobody to be glad. He don't want nobody to be excited about life through Jesus. He just want everybody to be loom and gloom and doom. And just do whatever and die and get them in hell. That's not the will of God. The will of God is for you to have the joy of the Lord, that you and the Lord will be one, and that the Lord can walk up and down in you, that he can speak to you, he can walk with you. Huh? There's a song that says, I come to the garden alone while the dew was still on the roses, and the voice that I hear sounding or singing in my ear, the Son of God, he walks with me and he talks with me and he tells me that I am his very own. And the joy that we share as we were tarry there. There was nobody else there, but as the joy that me and the Lord share. In the room, in the car, by ourselves, as we tarry there, no other love, nobody can tell me about his love, no other love will I ever know in this life, no other love, I don't care how long you've been married to your wife or your husband, I don't care, no other love can anybody give to you like the Lord, and that's what God wants to give to you. Is his love, his son Jesus Christ. The devil wants to give to you hate, anger, wrath, malice, strife, worry, confusion, so that it would take you out. Because that's pressure. That's really pressure on your heart naturally. that starts to bother you and mess with the chemistry of your body. That's why the joy of the Lord is our strength. God is waiting on you. You might think you're alone, but you don't have to be alone. God is waiting on you. 1 Peter 5:8 said, casting all your cares upon him, for he careth for you. We must ask God to give us strength to cast all our cares upon him. And I'm going to reiterate again, because the devil tries to take our strength so that we are not able to give or cast our problems onto the Lord. That's why he wants people to feel lonely. That's why he wants people to feel distressed and all stressed out. So that way when they're weak, they can't cast their burdens or cares on the Lord. Romans 8:31 says, what shall we then say to this, these things? If God be for us, who can be against us? Now, you might think that the world is against you, you're feeling alone, but if you give it to the Lord, he will help you fight your battles. Let Satan do his worst. He is chained and defeated because of what Jesus did at the cross. At the cross, on Calvary, at the cross that he bare. We have to go back to that cross that Jesus bled and died on, gave up the ghost. Because at the cross is where deliverance and healing comes from. By his stripes, we are healed. Spiritually healed from sin, physically healed from all loneliness with his stripes. That rugged cross that Jesus bare, you got to believe in what Jesus did on that cross for you. He wants to take away that loneliness. He wants to take away all your sins. But you got to give it. You got to give your life to him. I'm pleading and begging and beseeching you. Those of you that have not given your life over to the Lord, and you feeling that there's no way out, there's no way out of what I'm going through, and don't nobody understand. You don't understand, preacher, Pastor Williams. You don't understand. You, my wife walked out. My husband is beating my head in. My kids acting a clown. They're running the house. They're not going to school. My job is just talking to me crazy. I'm not able to pay my bills. I understand all of that. I hear all of that, let me say. But one thing I do understand and know, Jesus is a deliverer and a way maker. Give it to the Lord in prayer. As we pray now, Father, those that are going through, Father, touch right now. Save that unsaved person. Reclaim that backslider in the name of Jesus. You that's not saved right now, that's listening, just repeat after me, Lord, I'm sorry. And I repent of my sins. Wash me and cleanse me in your blood. Create in me a clean heart. And renew, hallelujah, a right spirit within me. Lord, those that have backslidden, let them just say, I'm sorry, Lord, for my sins. Those of us that's walking with you, Lord, I'm sorry for my sins, my wrongs. Whatever I have done that you see, I am sorry and I want to be better. better for you. That you will get the glory and praise and honor out of my life. Lord, save us some more. Sanctify us some more. And Lord, fill us again. In the name of Jesus. With the Holy Ghost. In the name of Jesus. And Father, I ask you to baptize and fill those saints that are not. Even our new converts. The new converts that just gave their life over to you. Baptize them and fill them with the Holy Ghost. Right now or in the days to come. That God, they will have the joy of the Lord. In Jesus' name I ask. Amen. You might think you're alone, but you're not alone. If you give it to the Lord, if you give it to the Lord, God will help you through this. Just give it to the Lord. God sees you. God understands. And God is there waiting for you just to say, Lord, here I am. Have your way. In Jesus' name. Amen. We're praying for you. We love you. Till the next time, God is waiting on you, and He loves you, and He wants to be one with you. Amen.
This is a song we do on Sunday morning, giving God glory and a great praise. You're just one praise away from your breakthrough.